Well, good evening. I'm Ray Sanchez, Superintendent of Schools, and I'm joined by our Assistant Superintendent for Business, Ms. Alita Zuber. I want to begin by thanking the members of the state legislature for this opportunity to speak on behalf of the Ossining School District. I also want to publicly acknowledge and thank the parents, students, board members, and staff that took the time to be here as well, and some of them are here still in the audience. So before you, I just, you know, our focus here is to discuss and share why the Ossining School District is so unique. And I just want to share some of the specific facts related to our school district, some of the items that we feel are our pride, and some of the challenges that we're facing. First of all, we serve 4,700 students of a very diverse population. That being said, that represents an increase of 17% since 2008, a total of 660 students. As we project and look forward to 2021, we anticipate an additional 400 students just between our middle school and high school. Last year, Intel named our high school the number one school for math and science in the nation. As has been discussed, we are committed to early childhood and have been since 1987. We have a pre-K that serves approximately 250 students, and we actually have a privately funded program that looks to serve students from 0 to 3 and have served over 2,400 students since 2002. All that with state aid being frozen as it relates to pre-K for the past 5 years. We have dual language programs that focus on biculturalism, biliteracy, and bilingualism. We are partnering with local universities to look to align our curriculum to form PTEC model. We very much support the athletics and the arts. In fact, our community was named the best community for music education for the third year in a row. And we've had approximately 70 scholar athlete teams over the past four years. Moving forward, we're looking to support our community through such initiatives as the Community Learning Center, which looks to leverage some of our local businesses, municipalities, and nonprofit organizations to provide services for our community members and our students. With that, we've seen many, many challenges and changes to our community. We've seen an increase in students living in poverty by 27%, 35% increase in free and reduced lunch students, 23% decrease in adjusted gross income per pupil, and a 7% decrease in property value per pupil as well. We've had to make some very difficult cuts to our programs. In fact, while we're seeing increases in enrollment, we've decreased over 100 positions over the past 4 years. We've cut library media specialists from our elementary schools. We've reduced teaching assistant hours across our district, and all our elementary programs have been eliminated. With that, I'd like to turn it over to Ms. Zuber, who will discuss a little bit more of the finances.
Hello. Good afternoon. Good evening. I just want to point out that Ossining School District is the only public school district here outside of the Big Five, so I think that deserves some recognition about how important we feel this issue is. We also have several parents and board members that are still here that have been waiting all day because they value this issue as much as we do. The thing that I want to point out the most is the issue of foundation aid. I don't want to talk about foundation aid from the perspective of it needing to be changed or the district necessary or to be funded even more, but from the perspective mostly of the fact that foundation aid has this hold harmless clause that is harming Ossining. Often when we are asked about revenue or we're asked to increase our revenue, they often ask us, well, what are your expenses? Have you reduced your expenses? I want to point out that before the tax cap came into play, we have been reducing our tax levy increases significantly. In fact, if you look at graph one, you'll notice that our tax levy increases were in the double-digit range. Now they're down to 2.92%. In both of 2 years that the tax levy cap has been in place, we've stayed under the tax cap. So we have a revenue problem. We don't have an expense problem, and I'll explain to you why. If you look at graph number two, You'll notice that in 2007-08, when Foundation Aid was first established, the New York State actually said that they would give us $2,343,000 per student, according to the formula. As you know, the formula identifies student need. It also identifies community wealth. And again, if you note that our community wealth is declining and our students' needs are increasing. In fact, like Mr. Sanchez said, we have a 35% increase in the number of students looking for free and reduced lunch, and a 27% increase in the number of students living in poverty since 2007-08. So Foundation Aid was established in order to help students in need, and it was also established to provide extra support for communities that can't afford to pay additional. So in 2007-08, like I said, we should have received $2,343,000 per pupil. Instead, again, looking at graph two, the middle bar is what we actually received, which is $1,500 per pupil. So already we started off in a deficit of $793 per pupil. If you look at 2014-15, our projections based on the increase in enrollment, and our enrollment continues to increase, that the state should be giving us about $3,800 per pupil. Instead, it will probably be giving us $1,546 per pupil based on the trends that we've received over the past 8 years. So if you notice, $1,546 per pupil is actually lower than the amount that we received in 2007-08. And as you can also see, the gray bar at the bottom just makes the problem even worse, and it exacerbates itself, it compounds itself to the point where we were at a negative $793 per pupil. Now we're at a negative $2,259 per pupil. I think what concerned me the most, and I have to thank organizations like AQE and SSFC, and looking at all of the data for Foundation Aids for the schools in New York State, what I found was there were many school districts that are very wealthy in our community that are receiving twice as much of Foundation Aid that they should be receiving according to the formula. In fact, the minimum amount of Foundation Aid that a school district can receive is $500 per pupil. There's a school district in our county that is receiving $900 per pupil and has been receiving that amount for a long period of time. Again, because our enrollment is increasing, we're seeing the decrease in the amount of per pupil. So again, we also have sustainable savings that we have been addressed. And because we're not only looking at getting more revenue, we're looking to cut our expenses. And we've in fact changed the trajectory of our major expenses, including health, including administrative costs, as well as our transportation costs. So if you look at the graph at number three, you'll notice that in 2009, and these are actual expenses taken from Open Book New York, you'll notice that our expenses, our actual expenses for our administration or general government was 11.2. In 2012-13, we're down to 10.7. For health, in 2009, we're 11.1, and now we're at 11.4. You'll note that there was a large spike of a $15.6 million. And under a tax cap environment, you know that's not sustainable. Our transportation cost in 2009 was $6.9 million, and now we're down to $6.6 million. So we've in fact reversed the trajectory of our expenses increasing. And what we're asking is that you actually change the trajectory as well by increasing the amount of Foundation Aid that Ossining should be receiving based on the formula. So we're asking that you unfreeze the hold harmless provision in the law and allow school districts like Ossining that have seen a significant increase in the number of students as well as students' needs and as well as increase in a decrease in the wealth of the community by providing us with the 66.5% Foundation Aid. If Foundation Aid was phased in according to the legislation, Ossining should have received or should receive next year an additional $7.5 million. So again, I just wanted to make it clear that we've done everything in our power to reduce expenses. We've reduced our energy, we're looking to do an energy performance contract. We received $1 million in competitive grants. We've worked with our teacher association and our administrator associations to stay within Triborough. We saved $1.2 million over 12 years by refinancing bonds. And we also was able to get the community to approve a $41.5 million capital project that does not increase the tax levy. So we've done all that we can to reduce expenses and in fact, reverse the trajectory of expenses. And what we're asking is that you provide us with the foundation aid that we're entitled to for the students that it's supposed to serve. And once again, we're just asking for the 66.5% amount of foundation aid that should be received in 2014-15, which equates to an additional $7.5 million.
Thank you. Okay, you're on. Are you the person that requested the Austin District to be on the agenda?
No. I didn't request, but I'm very glad that they are
good,
here.
Good.
Sandy Galef, and I represent the Austin community, but I think what came to mind was the fact that Austin is within a very wealthy county. Westchester County has the more wealth than anywhere, and yet within that sits pockets, and I look at Shelley Mayer there representing the Yonkers District. I represent Austin and Peekskill. There are places within our county where the needs are very, very great. And when you take the foundation aid and don't let it run its course when you have particularly an increase in population as they have, it's such a disservice to our children. So I think they've presented a very good case. And I know there are other communities probably that are in a similar situation as yours. Maybe you could discuss a few of them.
I want to point out that Ossining is one of 8 school districts in New York State that has seen an annual increase in enrollment and is also underfunded. Ossining is the 8th lowest funded school district in New York State of foundation aid, some numbers that we obviously aren't proud of. So again, we represent a very small minority of school districts that are underfunded with foundation aid and also have seen annual increased enrollments. In particular, my school district where I live, they closed the school because their enrollment has gone down. There's other school districts that have been able to do the same thing. But Austin can't do that. We, in fact, project an additional 400 students going forward. So the numbers are not declining. So it's as we have more students enrolling, the numerator gets bigger. If the denominator doesn't get any bigger, then we have a problem with the per pupil cost that you've seen that have exacerbated to a funding level of about 40%.
So I just want to add that obviously through attrition that provides its own savings. So obviously decreases in student population leads to less need for staff. Again, as noted before, we're seeing increases and we're going in the wrong direction. We're cutting staff while we're seeing more and more students. And this isn't a bubble. These are real students that are, as I noted earlier, we anticipate another 400 students just between our middle school and high school alone. And I think earlier on and throughout the theme has there's been a lot of discussion about early childhood. We've seen a stable amount of state aid of $850,000. That hasn't changed. So as the costs continue to increase as it relates to pre-kindergarten, our general budget has had to absorb those said costs. So you know, we're not shying away from our commitment. We value it. In fact, we've developed other programs to serve our students even at an earlier grade. Or earlier ages from 0 to 3. But we're reaching a point where some of the same programs that I shared with you and highlighted are becoming a challenge to maintain.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And next speaker.
Thank you.
Is Jeremy Johansson, New York Library Association. On deck is Michael Borges, School Boards Association.
Good evening. I'd like to thank all the members for this opportunity to speak to you. I'm not going to read my testimony to you and just going to make a few brief remarks because I know that each of you are library supporters. And you're familiar with our refrain, libraries are education. They deliver educational opportunities at every stage of life. And every time a New Yorker steps foot into a library, they are embracing the opportunity to better themselves. Libraries bridge the digital divide providing access to information infrastructure. And in nearly three quarters of New York's communities, the public library is the only source of free internet access. Libraries fuel economic development and have stepped up to serve as job placement and career training centers, and even serve as small business incubators. In the wake of Superstorm Sandy, libraries stepped up and served as first restorers, helping to bring the communities back to normalcy following the disaster. Libraries are also a model of efficiency. The library systems structure delivers, according to the State Education Department, a return on investment of over 7 to 1 for every dollar invested. But the meat of the issue here today is that library aid in New York State is woefully underfunded in the New York State budget. Library aid, as stipulated in education law, should be at $102 million. And in the executive budget, the governor cut us back to $81.6 million, which is 1997 levels. The investment in libraries is so small that even if it were fully funded, it would still represent only 0.1% of the state budget. So I'm calling on you all and asking for your support in putting in place a multi-year tiered commitment to funding libraries at 21st century levels so that they can live up to the potential that they hold for bettering the lives of every New Yorker.
Thank you. And for you and the next few speakers, I the order in which you're placed in this hearing means no disrespect. It's just that sometimes when scheduling takes place, things happen. And so I just want to make sure that you all know that. So I appreciate it. I'm with you 100%. I'm sure that's true for everybody that's bold enough to be here.
We do have a quick question for Mr. Ra.
Just quickly, and I don't know how much this really is a question, but obviously, again, we're kind of fighting from behind on the library issue. I agree with everything you said about the services the libraries provide. And there's a bit of irony, I think, to it, because libraries have demonstrated that kind of shared, cooperational, efficient model that we seem to be looking for from a lot of other entities. So there's a little bit of irony that, unfortunately, we seem to be fighting from behind each year with regard to the budget. But I think, especially in this time, with be it things going on in education, be it the job market out there and people looking for resources, whether it be to use a computer or go to books, you know, libraries seem to be more important than ever, even though we're seeing such an influx of, you know, using different technology, whether it's iPads, e-readers. There's still a value to, you know, a brick and mortar place where there's books, but also all the other resources that come along with it. So I just wanted to lend my support to hopefully get that restoration again in the budget this year, and hopefully we'll reach a time that we can be looking for additional funding rather than trying to just get a restoration. But thank you for your patience today, because it is a very important issue, I know, to all of my colleagues.
Thank you very much, Assemblyman. I couldn't have said it better myself.
Thank you. Michael Borges, Executive Director, New York Association of School Business Officials, to be followed by Robert Lowry. Looks like Mr. Borges is a split personality here. We got
We'll save you some time.
Yeah. Oh, we got School Boards Association.
Yeah, we got. I'm Mike Borges with the School Business Officials, and we have
Dave Little, School Boards. Bob Lowry from the Council of School Superintendents.
Boy, that's great. Thank you.
Thought
just
we'd be
for
efficient.
That, we're going to get more funding for all your organizations.
Great. Well, thank you for sticking around to hear us speak. I want to especially thank my own Senator Kachik for mentioning our report this morning that got released about school insolvency. Just briefly, I know since the hour's late and the time is limited, I just want to kind of go briefly over the governor's proposal. I'll just read my reading glasses. Basically, the $603 million increase in school aid is really composed of a $323 million restoration of GEA, so it's no new money there, which leaves about $1.3 billion left to restore, which, if you go with $323 million, is another 4 or 5 years' worth of restorations. The remaining $603 is $280 million or more for expense-based aid, which is really reimbursing school districts for expenses that they incurred the previous year. Again, no new money for operating costs. There is $74 million allocated to an undefined fiscal stabilization line. This compares to the $203 million last year that the governor put in for fiscal stabilization. The executive budget proposal on the property tax freeze, again, only seeks to cap our local revenues and not our expenses. We're still waiting on details on how that would work and how it would be implemented. The $2 billion Technology Bond Act, Smart Schools Bond Act, we support the intent, but it would make more sense and cost taxpayers less to fund these technology purchases by increasing hardware and technology aid categories. It makes no sense to borrow money to pay for iPads or tablets that have a shelf life of 3 to 5 years. Pre-K initiative, again, another worthy initiative, and give it unlimited resources, something the state should invest in. But given our current state of limited resources and tax caps and cuts in aid, we need to invest in K-12 first. Restore all the GEA, fully fund foundation aid, and before embarking on any new initiatives, we should invest in K-12. The tax cap, as someone else had mentioned earlier, is going to be 1.46% for the coming school year, further reducing local resources for our schools. Particularly hard, given that the expected increase in TRS is going to be between 6 and 9%. Increases in healthcare costs expected around 7%. And I just read the other day that natural gas costs have doubled in the last couple of weeks. And also the folks from Ossining mentioned that, the lady from Buffalo, one of our members from Buffalo, mentioned the fact that their entire state aid increase was going to be taken up by their pension costs. Barbara Smith from Buffalo. The executive budget also fails to address the building aid interest rate recalculation, which will cost school districts approximately $26 million. It's about 500 school districts statewide will lose out on $26 million in building aid because the governor did not include omit the rate recalculation like he did in the previous year. Last year, we were able to secure a two-year moratorium on recalculating the interest rate, which saved school districts about $32 million. Included on our handout is our school aid proposal, which calls for about $2.6 billion in additional school aid and mandate relief over the next year. Although we phase out the GEA over 3 years and phase in the foundation aid formula over the same time period. We also asked for, in our handouts, we also have our report about school insolvency, which examines recent data that puts in perspective the threat of both fiscal and educational insolvency that many school districts face. In the report, it shows that 261 school districts had reductions in fund balances, 544 school districts lost staff, and most troubling are the 206 school districts who lost staff and fund balances during that three-year time period. During the last five school years, between 2008, 2009, and 2012, 2013, schools lost 10% of their professional staff and 3% of their pupils. And this kind of rate of attrition is not sustainable. Also, in terms of mandate relief, again, as many other folks have mentioned, there is minimal, if not any, mandate relief in the governor's proposal. And there's lots of recommendations that are out there, small to large, which we think the legislature consider as a way to reducing our expenses. Again, thank you again for letting me the opportunity to speak, and I'll turn it over to, I think Bob's next on the list.
Go ahead, Bob. Well, thank you. Chairwoman Nolan, Chairman DeFrancisco, and other members of the legislature. I'm Bob Lowry, Deputy Director of the New York State Council of School Superintendents. With my testimony is a copy of a report we released 2 weeks ago. You should have already received it, titled Not Out of the Woods. It's our third annual survey of superintendents on financial matters. And the title reflects the conclusion that despite the state aid increases of the last 2 years, too many districts are worried about either financial or educational insolvency or both, and too few have been able to restore cuts to programs, damage to programs over the last several years. Our survey shows that over the next 4 years, over a third of superintendents anticipate that their districts could become financially insolvent, and over 43% say their districts could become educationally insolvent, unable to fund all the state and federal instructional and student service requirements. We also have a chart showing that, again, despite the state aid increase this year, in 19 categories of programs and services, more superintendents anticipate a negative impact on those areas than a positive, except in one area, school safety. And most of the positive responses are from the lower Hudson Valley, the area across the border from Newtown, Connecticut. For the third year in a row, 40% of superintendents anticipate a negative impact from their budget on extra help for students who need it. With the improvements in the state fiscal outlook, with the state aid increases of the last 2 years, I think some optimism was starting to develop that perhaps there was light at the end of the tunnel, that we could begin to make some progress in reversing the damage of the last 2 years. Unfortunately, the governor's budget just doesn't do enough to help districts either with near-term challenges of putting together budgets for next year or the longer-term challenges that many of them worry about. Even with the increase this year, over 60% of the districts in the state would get less help than in 2008-09, 6 years in the past. And if you leave out building aid, the figure rises to over 80%. It's true, as the governor has said, that enrollment has gone down in many districts. But other things have gone up. The consumer price index by 2.2% a year. The contribution rate for the teacher's retirement system has more than doubled. Health insurance premiums for the state, those have gone up by 4% a year. And also mandates, teacher evaluation and principal evaluation mandates, and the Common Core. The governor's budget would increase basic school aid that appears on the school aid runs by $603 million, or 2.9%. The seven statewide education groups, including R3 plus NYSET, and the PTA, SANEs, and the Big Five, have said $1.5 billion would be needed just to maintain current services, given the limits on the ability to raise money locally through created by the property tax cap. So we see an increase of $1.5 billion is needed, again, just to maintain current services. We oppose the governor's property tax freeze proposal. It would make more sense to start to phase in a circuit breaker instead as a way to provide targeted help to the people who most need help. The freeze would put local leaders in a no-win position. Either they would have to forego revenues, ask for an override, and they'd either have to forego asking voters for an override of the tax cap to give them the revenues they may see as needed to preserve opportunities for students, or ask their residents to forego the rebates that would create the freeze, almost assuring that their budget would be voted down, and then they wouldn't be able to raise their tax levy at all. We also think the proposal to require districts to participate in a shared services or consolidation plan with other districts led by the largest district in their BOCES doesn't make sense. We support efforts to streamline voluntary consolidation, to promote more sharing of services and regional high schools, but many districts have already exhausted the opportunities that are out there to share services, and 8 out of the last 10 attempts to consolidate districts have been voted down. We do support efforts to expand pre-K, and the technology bond issue might do some good. We share the observation that some of the technology that districts need to buy now, it isn't appropriate to fund through bond issues, but it could do some good, and it is welcome that the bond issue would support purchase of a construction of pre-K space. The last thing I'll say is I've been involved with education policy for over 25 years. I've never seen the level of discord that we have right now. The governor's called for a panel to review implementation of the Common Core. We appreciate the efforts by Senator Flanagan and Assemblywoman Nolan convening hearings on issues related to the region's reform agenda. The governor's panel could provide a vehicle for focusing the discussion to ensure that we get thoughtful, constructive solutions developed and put on the table. We do think that one of the reasons why we got here is that policymakers didn't listen to practitioners in the field, so it will be important for this panel to include practicing educators and school district leaders and to listen to what they have to say. I do want to thank you for your efforts in support of improving the rate setting process for the 853 schools and for your past support, and we look forward to working with you and with our colleagues to produce a budget that does address the long-term challenges that our school districts are still facing.
I'm Dave Little from the School Boards Association. I think perhaps the best way that I can encapsulate the negotiations that are before you is by the analogy that I heard day before yesterday about the veterinarian and taxidermist that went into business together, the sign out front saying, either way, you'll get your dog back. With all due respect, personal respect to the governor, I think from a public policy standpoint, the executive budget proposal that he's put before you for consideration would lead us with a dead dog. You know, we've got an analysis by the Educational Conference Board that we're all members of that would indicate that simply without any additions whatsoever, simply to roll over existing programs and services by cost from this year to next year takes $2.2 billion. With a 1.4% tax cap imposed on school districts, they're able to raise $700 million. That leaves $1.5 billion for the state if they're to stay at the cap. The governor has proposed $608 million. He's proposed a couple hundred million for extraneous programs, perhaps worthwhile programs beyond that, but $608 million directly to support that $1.5 billion that's needed for next year. Quite honestly, that's not a plan for building what he describes as world-class schools of the future. That's a plan for systematically decommissioning our public educational system. We have tremendous efforts ongoing out there to try and address this, shared services, and yet the proposals, when taken in the aggregate that he's proposed, are tremendously destructive. The property tax relief proposal makes great sense, except that you're presupposing that districts, as they have in the past, would stay at or below the cap. The cap, to date, has been an extremely effective mechanism of restraining school spending. Virtually no school districts, statistically, are successful in going over the cap, and at the same time, school districts that stay below it have historically been successful in their budget votes. So to take that amount and say that we're going to reward taxpayers in districts that stay at the cap and then systematically have an amount of money that's less than half of what's required to allow them to get to the cap with their current programs presupposes that you're going to cut programs and services at a tremendous rate. It's in my mind disingenuous to presuppose that school districts would be able to do that, when the chart that you'll see in our testimony, you can see your own areas, the areas that you represent, and virtually all areas of the state show that school districts are being funded at 2008, 2009 levels. Quite honestly, what that means is that your local taxpayers have borne the whole brunt of the burden of increases for 5 years. And that's with the tax cap, and school districts were self-imposing a tax cap before there was a statutory one. So the program for a $2 billion bond act, as speculative as that is, and despite the fact that it uses the exact same method of financing that the governor criticized as creating a $10 billion deficit, that would be helpful. Certainly money for pre-K and money for after school and money for teacher bonuses would all be helpful. In the overall scheme of things. But the fact of the matter is that none of it makes any sense if you can't pay for the things that you've got already. Why would we have universal pre-K at the expense of cutting half-day and full-day kindergarten programs and send kids home? The plan doesn't make sense as it's written. You've done a good job in the past of trying to synthesize those initial efforts into a final product. We would ask that you make that effort again this year. One thing that I would say in support of the governor's proposal, the one mandate relief proposal that he includes, flexible waivers for special education that would be in compliance with federal law, makes perfect sense. We have a duplicative and costly system in New York State. As the son of the Russell Sage's director of special education, I can tell you that the way that we do things is costly beyond belief to my colleagues around the country. We don't provide services any better, but we provide them in a much more costly manner. And I would ask you to take a look at that and support that recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you. So I take your remark as if the patient dies or the dog dies, it's not going to do much good to give them pre-K instruction.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
that's
where we
a
are.
Good analogy or not, but in any event, are you basically saying that you'd like, if you had your druthers, all those special packages, whether it's the $100 million for pre-K, whatever it is for competitive grants for teachers of excellence and all that stuff, it's more important at this point to use those dollars because of the crisis to either eliminate the gap elimination or to drive more money to the foundation aid.
Much as I hate to admit it, I surpassed Bob's years. This is my 30th year either working in the legislature or working on education with all of you. And I will tell you, I've never seen a five-year period of time that has been any more, I don't want to say destructive, but as...
Okay, but what's the answer? We'd love to hear the preamble, but what's the answer?
Yeah, we like to see that. Yeah, competitive grants don't work for school districts.
We've got to pay for what we've got before we start paying new
things.
Yeah, and I would say, you know, that's a predominant reaction from our members is this is great stuff, but what about the basics? And, you know, the pre-K proposal, that would be for districts to opt in. I think in order for districts to opt in, they want to be assured that the funding for pre-K is going to be sustained, but also the funding for what comes after, kindergarten, first grade, and second grade. So I don't think you're going to be successful phasing in pre-K without taking care of
right, K. And I'm not suggesting that you're against pre-K or anything like that, but I'm just saying that
if we had prioritized, would we prioritize K-12 spending over pre-K spending?
Or a new program?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Walter has a question. Walter.
There we go. Thank you. You know, the governor has put forth that the property tax is the most onerous tax in the state of New York and says that the cause of that during both the State of the State and the budget presentation was the number of local governments that we have. It always seemed to me that the number of state mandates that we had drove our property tax. But so I'd really like to hear from you. Do you see an opportunity to consolidate and share services that would have significant savings to our property tax, which the school tax is the largest part of that? Or in reality, is it the state mandates that are driving your costs?
They've been sharing services at a dramatic rate for the past 5 years. There are some school districts that even share superintendents at this point and other school officials. There's been tremendous resistance thus far in the legislature to address the concept of regional high schools, which is a middle ground between the mergers and consolidations that have been largely rejected by the vast majority of communities that have proposed them. Regional high schools are a concept that is 40 to 50 years old and successfully used in other states. We haven't been able to try and figure out a construct that makes it work. There are certainly opportunities for further shared services, but at some point, you have to figure out whether or not you're going to sustain what you have or provide the opportunities through mandate relief to do something else. Neither the governor nor the legislature has provided that mandate relief thus far to an extent that makes any kind of financial replacement for the kind of aid that we need to move forward.
There actually are three regional high schools operating in actually Nassau County, which work really well, and it's beyond my understanding why the region's proposal for regional high schools hasn't really moved forward, because I think we could all endorse the idea of regional high schools as being the less threatening and the least easy, I mean, the easier thing to achieve as opposed to consolidation, as Bob was saying. I think the last four votes on consolidation of school districts went down in flames, and in a large part because of schools or communities didn't want to lose their identity, and two, always one of those communities see their tax levies go up and the other one goes down. So until there's a way of addressing the inequities of the merger, you're going to see a lot more of those consolidations fail.
Mr. Oaks? Yeah,
I'd say, you know, the consolidations that have pursued the idea of regional high schools, those are more about preserving opportunities for children than reducing costs. There probably are further opportunities for savings in shared services, administrative services, and we ought to pursue them. But central administrative spending, according to the State Education Department, is 3% of district budgets. You know, if we were creating a state from scratch, we wouldn't have 700 school districts. But in fact, 29 states have more school districts relative to enrollment than we do. That's not the reason why our spending is so high. It is the mandates.
Correct. Just a quick question. You were talking before about some of the challenges in funding the universal pre-K proposals and whatever. Have you had any sense yet from your membership of how many might, should the funding be there? how many might take advantage of it, or is the, you raised the concern of worrying would it be available in the future and whatever, but are these districts even in a position to take advantage of it at this point because of so many of the other uncertainties in their funding?
There are a few that would be in a position to do that, but there is universal skepticism about the longevity of the funding. I think they only need to go as far as foundation aid, the basic funding for school districts. There's not a penny of an increase in foundation aid in this budget. So when you don't have an increase in that, why would you expect to have funding in perpetuity for a brand new program?
And not every school district in the state has full-day kindergarten. So I think before you go to pre-K, you might want to make sure that every school district in the state at least offers full-day kindergarten.
And there's a transportation issue and the construction issue to have the facilities associated with school districts to provide pre-K is based on the speculative proposition of a statewide bond proposition that in itself assumes that there would be support from the highly populated areas of the state that already have broadband access and generally have access to computer hardware for their kids. So the success of that bond proposition, you know, I would say is tenuous at best. And to base the construction of the facilities you need for a $1.5 billion operating proposal for pre-K, to me, is tenuous at best.
I asked the commissioner this morning, and early childhood is saying maybe would a better proposal be to lump pre-K through two and allowing some of those resources if it were trying to focus on early education so that local districts might be able to make some determinations on going to full day kindergarten, et cetera.
Assemblyman, all I would tell you about that, and certainly from an operational standpoint, the flexibility would be welcome. But in saying that we need to pay for what we have first, we also recognize that in many areas there's tremendous need for universal pre-K. There are young students that are dramatically in need of an improved environment to be able to be successful later on.
Thank you.
Senator Krueger.
Thank you, gentlemen. I will get back to your questions. I just want to thank you all for incredibly thorough testimony, the three different documents that you submitted. And there's a lot of discussion here, but obviously the highlighted theme is when you look at how much money has been removed from the educational system over the last few years, you all find yourselves desperate and your school districts desperate. And I don't think it's really a debate about the pros and cons of UPK, but rather the need to have the education funds to do what you're trying to do with statistically so much less than what you were anticipating having at this point in history. And I'm just curious because the other side of the governor's argument is if he uses this freeze and circuit breaker to require shared services, that it'll all work out within 3 years. So I'm wondering, have you also, because you've done incredible work here, evaluated, can you reduce the number of school districts in 3 years? Can you have a lot of savings that way?
Well, you know, most of the money is in the buildings, you know, the schools. It's not in the central offices. And as David said, we have district sharing superintendents now.
Business officials.
I was in the Binghamton area last Thursday evening. Basically, the BOCES is operating all the business offices for all the districts, as I understand
central it. Central business offices.
Yeah, a central business office. So that kind of thing is going on. It is a way to save money. But again, most of the money is in the school buildings. And as we said, voters, often it's the case that school district leaders, superintendents, and boards are ahead of the community saying, you know, we need to look at consolidation. And often it's more about preserving opportunities for kids than about lowering taxes. But 8 out of the last 10 attempts to merge districts have been voted down. And I think all of the mergers that have been put up for votes since the start of this school year have been rejected. So voters are resistant to doing that. And again, most of the money is in instruction. 75% of school spending is instruction. I would say, you know, there has been consolidation that's gone on. It's consolidation of school buildings. I think in districts with over 5,000 students, over 29% of them have closed at least one school building in the last 3 years, according to our survey. So that's going on. I think people are looking at for ways to avoid affecting instruction and other student services, but again, that part of the school budget, central administration, is small to begin with.
Study after study says that there's no real fiscal savings in trying to merge school districts, particularly in New York State, where you have to level up the contracts of the employees within the district, and our money's in people. You know, so if you're trying to do the merger to expand educational opportunities and you're trying to retain the people, and half of the people are making less than the others, and you're going to increase their salary to the new entity, the savings that you have for the few administrators that you lose in the process is more than offset by that, as well as by the increased transportation that you have for schools. The really succinct answer to your question is, we can't get there in the third year because we can't get there in the first year. With $608 million, we can't keep districts under the cap. Okay, and everything is predicated on that.
One of the reports you were talking about, Syracuse University did a study two or three years ago, which looked at school district consolidation, and they found that school districts of less than 1,500, it made sense, but over 1,500, it made no economic sense to merge. So there's no savings involved in merging school districts of a certain size. And you want to go to look at Syracuse University.
And when Syracuse University speaks, people listen.
Yes, that's what it said.
We certainly do.
Senator Katchen.
I just wanted to thank all of your organizations for the work that you do and the amount of time you put into helping us understand the system we're in with the education funding, and I was glad to see this morning. I mean, this is the kind of data we need to understand before we make these decisions, so I appreciate the amount of work and effort to get this out today and help us understand the impact this budget is having and has been and the past 5 years have had on our school districts. I wanted to thank you.
And I thank your efforts in consolidating the three speakers into one time slot.
Sure. I also wanted to point out
we're just modeling.
And I saw that there was a sort of a theme there of the road traveled. I don't know if that was an intentional, but we.
I just want to point out, though, that we did drop off at the beginning of January the school district backbook with the maps, and
I didn't get that.
It was very helpful.
I dropped it off your office this morning, so you should have gotten it. If you haven't gotten it, please don't hesitate to contact us. This is very valuable information.
We're going to see if some of these people have to flip.
No, let's just.
What you want to just keep going? All right. Next is Fight Crime, Invest in Kids. Craig Apple, Albany County Sheriff. F. Michael Tucker, the President and CEO of the Center for Economic Growth. And Major General Michael Hall, retired U.S. Air Force, which we're always very honored to have. People who served our country be with us. We have still quite a few other names on this list. If someone wants to leave their testimony, come down and see the staff, and we'll work it out as best we can. And we really want to thank you and thank the colleagues. I know I see some still in the room, and appreciate it very much.
On deck is Bishop William Murphy. Is he here or someone on his behalf?
Jim Coltera, perhaps, from the Catholic Conference.
Anybody here on behalf of the Catholic Conference? All right. And then on deck is Mariah Flavin. Is she here? Mariah's given up, too, and I don't blame her.
Policy Associate for Early Education Citizens Committee for Children. She might say it, Maura.
Maura? Okay, that Mariah. Okay. She's a singer.
Hillside Family of Agencies?
They're gone.
Okay.
They're gone.
New York Association for Pupil Transportation, Peter Minella. Come down in the front.
You're next, Peter.
Okay. New York School Bus Contractors. If they're still here, come down in the front. United Jewish Appeal, Darcy Hirsch, Director of Day School Advocacy. If you're still here, come down in the front. Legal Women Voters, Marion Bott. I see her, but I know she's in the front already. And Jeff Leb from the Orthodox Union. And I guess if Jeff Leb is here from the Orthodox Union, maybe he can round up Jim Coltera from the Catholic Conference. And we'll have an ecumenical service right here at the hearing.
Okay.
So thank you, and thank you for your patience, and please go ahead and introduce yourselves.
First of all, thank you for hanging in there, and something that's very important to us. Thank you, members of the committee, for giving us the opportunity to testify today. We are members of Fight Crime, Invest in Kids, America's Edge, and Mission and Readiness. a family of organizations known as a Council for a Strong America that leverage the voices of unique and often unexpected messengers and support of proven investments in children. I am Albany County Sheriff Craig Apple, and I'm a member of Fight Crime, Invest in Kids. With a membership of more than 260 law enforcement leaders and crime survivors across the state. I'm here today to talk about pre-K and after-school programs. We thank policymakers for elevating these issues. Programs have long been underfunded and failed to serve a majority of the children. It's time to commit adequate resources to both initiatives and provide access to high-quality programs to all children in this state, especially those most at risk. The pre-K connection is simple. Pay now or pay later. We currently spend $2.8 billion a year on the incarceration of about 66,000 people. A solid investment in pre-K would lead to better performance in school, fewer high school dropouts, and ultimately fewer crimes committed and a reduction in the number of prisoners. While we applaud the governor for his commitment to universal, full-day, high-quality pre-K, his proposed $100 million investment for the first year of implementation falls short of our executive budget request of $225 million. We ask for at least $225 from the state to support local districts to add new, high-quality, full-day pre-K seats. The same holds true for after school. A real investment will make a big difference in the lives of thousands of children who will find stability and skill building in high-quality programs. We're asking for an investment of $9 million in quality infrastructure in fiscal 14 and 15, in preparation for 5 years of investment beginning with $160 million in fiscal 15 and 16. That's the key. These programs must be high quality, and we must invest the appropriate resources in them to ensure this. As my colleague Michael Tucker will tell you, businesses understand quality, and we must insist on it for our children. We need to stop the cycle of incarceration, and by investing in our children, I believe it's a step in the right direction. We need to keep our kids interested, educated, and watch them thrive, not strive. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Mike Tucker, the president of the Center for Economic Growth, the regional economic development organization here in New York's Tech Valley. I'm also a member of America's Edge, a group of 150 business leaders from across the state. We believe that we can strengthen business by a proven investment in our children. As Sheriff Apple has said, businesses work hard to provide quality goods and services for their clients and customers. And any investment in early learning, whether it's in pre-K or childcare, must ensure the highest quality to ensure that this child is taken care of. If it does not, we will not only do our children a disservice, but we will not receive a suitable return on the state taxpayers' investment. That return is $1.86 for every dollar spent in the early learning sector, more than the revenues from construction, retail, manufacturing, transportation, and utility investments. And that's money that stays in our local communities. I urge you to keep that in mind as you work with your colleagues on economic development strategies throughout the state. In addition to early learning, I'm here today to talk about business leaders' commitment to models along the education continuum that help students develop the skills needed in
school district that's utilizing the services of a private contractor is indirectly funding the sales tax on the fuel, maintenance, parts, and vehicle itself purchased by the private operator. We are here today to offer a cost-saving solution rather than ask you for any additional money or funding. And really, we believe that it's just time to end this silly budget merry-go-round. By exempting school buses from sales tax, we're simply following something that the governor and the legislature had realized in the mid-1990s when coach buses were exempt from sales tax. Coach buses were exempt from sales tax because of the public and environmental benefits associated with riding a bus, and it only seems logical that school buses should receive the same treatment. As I conclude with my remarks, I know that every dollar of savings is important, and we believe that this initiative would not only save school districts and, again, prevent the continuation of this budget merry-go-round, but put savings back where it belongs in our classrooms. Thank you again for the opportunity to speak, and we look forward to working with you as we move forward.
Just a question, the $12 million in savings, are you going to be reducing your fees for bus service by $12 million so the savings go to the state rather than you?
Excellent question.
Very good question.
First, looking back, certainly we're not asking for any sales tax back on vehicles that we already have purchased. You know, that's gone. But moving forward, it will help us control our costs and help us mirror the governor's.
I got the point. And you're happy with the budget?
We are happy with the transportation.
Well, if we knew you're both happy, we would have had you first today. Because you're the first one. We waited all this time to find someone who's relatively pleased. Any questions?
We yield back a minute.
Yeah. Anyone else? All right. Thank you. All right, we're getting down to the nitty-gritty.
We're on a roll, and I do want to thank you for having a happy note, because I'm getting a little giddy up here from the hours, so thank you very much. Thank you.
United Jewish Appeal Federation, I understand.
Darcy Hirsch? Darcy?
Oh, she is here.
And then I guess maybe...
You want to team up with the Orthodox Union, too?
Sure thing.
Okay.
Okay, very good.
And then the final witness will be Marion Bott from the League of Women Voters. Is that how we're going to do that?
That sounds
and,
great.
And Miss Bartoletti, of course, if she's there.
Of course.
However you ladies want to do it. Is there anybody, I hate to ask this because we really don't want to stay too much longer, but is there anyone in the audience remaining that has been overlooked, or is there any issue we need to address?
I object.
They've all been here so long, the few that are still here, we want to make sure we took care of them, that's all.
Thank you. Okay. Whenever you're ready, you can start.
Okay. Good evening. Thank you all for sticking around tonight to hear the two of us speak about non-public schools and particularly the Jewish schools. Thank you, Senator DeFrancisco, Chairwoman Nolan, Chairman Flanagan, honorable members. My name is Darcy Hirsch, and I'm Director of Day School Advocacy at the United Jewish Appeal Federation of New York, a philanthropy that raises over $200 million annually from about 60,000 donors in New York City, Long Island, and Westchester. We operate over 100 health and social service agencies and help people worldwide. We have a very strong investment in Jewish education and believe that every willing family should be able to afford a quality Jewish education. And I have worked with Jeff here and with the leadership over the past couple years to help secure additional funding for non-public schools and appreciate your support, particularly for the mandated services and cap reimbursements that we have seen over the past couple years, in addition to the non-public school safety program, the $4.5 million that were included in the budget last year, that have been so meaningful both to the schools and to families who are thrilled to know that the state is interested in helping to keep their children safe and secure. We are very pleased with the governor's executive budget proposal, which includes a 3.8% increase in cap and mandated services reimbursement, and also $4.5 million again this year to fund the school security initiative. The cap funding is $14 million short of the $59 million expenses accrued by the non-public schools in the 2012 school year, and we hope to work with you to ensure that those additional funds are included in the final budget. We also praise Governor Cuomo for the additional funding for Universal Pre-K, as well as his Smart Schools initiative, which we hope that the non-public schools will be able to participate in through equitably. Lastly, and most importantly, we ask that the Education Investment Tax Credit bill be considered to be included in the final budget. This bill, which many of you may be familiar with, would allocate $250 million worth of tax credits to be available to donors to both private school scholarship organizations and entities that serve public schools. The goal of this program is to drive private investment into education in New York State in general by providing an incentive for donors to contribute both to public and private school entities. As high as 50% of children at Jewish schools are on some sort of scholarship aid. Families are struggling to afford to afford tuition, and schools often will admit needy students at the risk of covering costs, whether it's providing competitive teacher salaries and benefits or keeping up with up-to-date technology. And so we believe that the Education Investment Tax Credit bill would really drive much funding into scholarships and thus alleviating this issue for the private schools. Thank you for your consideration. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Jeff?
All right. Thank you very much. I have good afternoon in my notes, but I'm going to say good evening. I'm going to take the liberty of saying good evening. And thank you very much for sticking around to hear us out. We really appreciate it. Good evening, Chairman DeFrancisco, Chairman Flanagan, Chairwoman Nolan, Senator Krueger, Assemblyman Goldfeder, Assemblyman Oaks, Assemblyman Roth.
And everybody else. And everybody else.
Everybody. I want to make everyone feel special. But seriously, thank you very much for sticking around and hearing us out. I would love to say ditto to what Ms. Hirsch just said. And have an evening, but I'm a little bit more complicated than that, so I'll make it very quick. The education investment tax credit that we mentioned, I think that'll be a great idea for us to be able to pass. I know that there's some issues with it, but hopefully we can work through that through negotiations. By the way, I represent the Orthodox Union Advocacy Center, and the Orthodox Union and the Teach LES Initiative. Our sole priority in Albany and New York City is to advocate on behalf of non-public schools, non-public schools parents, and the students that attend it, the 125,000 or so Jewish students that attend those schools. We're very, very pleased. We're very happy, for the most part, with the budget. The mandated services reimbursement, we have full funding. We have payment towards the arrears, which is about $7 million this year in the governor's executive budget proposal. CAP, as Darcy mentioned, is about $14 million below what it should be. So that would put us at full funding level, $14 million, which would be very much appreciated. The governor was kind enough to include in his proposal $4.5 million for security funding, which puts us at $9 million in correlation with the SAFE Act that was passed last year that benefited public schools, but not non-public schools. So for us, it's really an issue of parity, of just having things like safety and technology and all other essential services be provided to public school students and private school students. Because, you know, our mentality is that it doesn't make a difference if you attend public school or private school. If you're a student, if you're a child in the school, you should be able to have access to the same sort of essential services that are made accessible to all public school students. And our concern is that the $2 billion Smart Schools initiative will leave out the non-public schools. We're concerned about that. We would hope that, as you know, we're all paying for the bond, so we would all have access to those funds, and as well as the UPK. UPK is a great program. It provides an essential service to all children, all students, and we're hoping as well that anything that's made available to public school students, as far as UPK is concerned, is made available to non-public school students as well. And that's really all I have to comment on this. I'd be happy to answer any questions as well, and I thank you very much all for your time.
Assemblyman Goldfeder? Okay.
And thank you for the patience. I know it would have been an ecumenical presentation because I got a feeling the Catholic Conference had the same priorities as you had. So thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you very much for your time.
And now for the featured speaker. The last of the evening, League of Women Voters, Marion Bott.
And let me just say, we're going to follow up with you on some of these issues, obviously. And also, you know, Speaker Silver had really worked hard. We had a child care credit that we did a while ago, and I don't see it in your list, but we will follow up on some of the issues that we care about. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And thank you for your patience.
And thank you for all of the work that you do. I know the League is a volunteer group, and to stay this many hours and be with us, you know, we really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Well, okay. I'm looking forward to the first part of this discussion. I'm Marion Bott. I'm the Education Finance Specialist for the New York State League of Women Voters.
We have to thank our stenographer.
Barbara Bartoletti is here behind me. She's our legislative director. I'm going to take my comments out of order because of the prior speakers, because I want to make sure that all of you know that the League not only opposes but vehemently opposes the tax credit proposal. Just for the record, I just want to make sure that you all know the bill numbers that I'm talking about are S-4099, I think I have that one memorized, and the Assembly bill, and I understand it's in discussions to amend it, but there's also an Assembly counterpart that's not quite the same acoustic bill. Our reasons, among others, are that the League has long opposed the use of taxpayer dollars for private purposes. We believe the taxpayer dollars belong in public schools. So just to make sure that the audience understands that a tax credit is a different kettle of fish than a tax deduction. We all contribute to the charities of our choice. Foundation for Opportunities in Education, otherwise known as FOE, and the Coalition for Opportunities in Education, otherwise known as CO, led by the Brighter Choice people, have now done, and it has been reported on their Form 990, although we can't see their most current Form 990. Very clearly, they have targeted the notion that they're going to use their combined powers as a 501c3 and a 501c4, as well as a 527 PAC, and basically use their legal powers to use to the maximum extent possible their not only grassroots lobbying percentage allocation, but also their direct lobbying contributions. If you want to know more about this, David McKay Wilson has reported on it in the press in the last few weeks. The point is that the motivation for this bill is not clearly to benefit the students that the taxpayers of New York are trying so desperately to support. So I just want to make very clear how the League stands on that, and we're going to fight this bill.
I think you're pretty clear.
Good.
Okay.
Now, the only other thing I want to talk about is anything that we didn't talk about today that has numbers in it. So the first thing we didn't talk about today that has numbers in it is what do people pay for a good quality private school preschool program in New York City? I have with me a document from the brand new Avenues School in New York City, which is a pre-K through 12 school. The tuition is $41,650. The tuitions for ongoing schools in Liz and my senatorial district are between $35,000 and $40,000. So just for the record, when a student's parents can afford to send their kid to a good school and they don't want their kid in a public school in New York City, not only do they pay that $35,000 to $41,000 tuition, but they also will donate their tax-deductible contributions to helping the scholarship students in that school. So that wasn't mentioned earlier. Now, you all love when I bring up STAR because you claim it's not part of your committee's purview, but just as a reminder and for the record, STAR comprises 17%, $3.4 billion, 17% of the budget that we're now considering. We are cheering that the governor has put property tax credits on the table. I've been discussing a little bit with the staff of the Empire Center how we might redefine ability to pay. So I pulled up the financial aid application, FAST, financial aid for school tuition for the Avenue School, to see what it is that they want to know from families who are asking for aid. So it's a comprehensive approach. It's not just one line item. It's not just your personal income. It's a variety of factors that that reflect upon your family's ability to pay. This is what we should have in a property tax circuit breaker. We should phase out STAR. We should have a property tax circuit breaker that targets not who's going to get reelected, but who really needs the property tax relief so that we can more efficiently use our tax dollars. I think that's the last number. There may be one more. Let me just double check. The tax commission reported that, which is progress, that 70% of the taxing jurisdictions in the state have actually reformed their assessment and collection procedures. That means 30% of them have not. That means almost 300 taxing jurisdictions still have outmoded and unfair and erratic valuations of property. And we saw how much that hurt Long Island. I believe it was one of the Long Island newspapers during our hearings, during the Education Reform Commission hearings, had a big display of all the disparities that were pointed out when a certain taxpayer would go and ask for tax relief and then his or her neighbor did not. So we need to clean up assessment and collection. We need to do a better job of that. That's a strong league position. Pre-K, I noted on the Byram Hills School website that they have a community pre-K membership program for $45. This is a very wealthy community. I believe the governor's children went there. In Westchester County, I live, for example, dually in New York City and in Rye, New York. We have a private pre-K program that's $7,500 a pupil. There's one in Scarsdale that's $5,700 a pupil. The numbers that are being talked about for high needs children who really need, frankly, in many cases, much more one-on-one attention. These numbers are lowballed. What we're talking about in terms of what we should be doing for a pre-K program, the governor's program is, I'm sorry, it is a lowball number. As to Mayor de Blasio's suggestion, I live in the district. If you want us to contribute, I think there are very few people. I agree with what Liz said earlier. There will be very few people who can justify saying that less fortunate children don't deserve the same thing that you'd go to a charity auction and spend or go on a vacation or whatever. I think that we can do this, but we have to make sure that we don't say that $7,111, which I think is what I calculated while I was sitting waiting. I think that's what John King was saying. He was saying $1.6 billion, and you take that times the number of the students in the whole state that might use the program, and I think that number calculates at $7,111, and that's almost $5,000 less than they're spending in New Jersey. So we have to be careful about those numbers. And I'm sorry to keep you late, but I just wanted to get those numbers out there.
We appreciate it. Believe me, we were just kind of laughing because we thought for a minute some other people had walked in to testify, but that's not the case. Do we really have a question on this side? Senator Goldfeder.
Okay. I just want to thank the League of Women Voters and appreciate all the efforts you do, but I want to be very clear because I know that you are very, you were very clear about your feelings in the presentation, but you know, parents of non-public school students pay taxes as well, and they want to make sure that their children are getting the best possible education. And while I'm a proud supporter of public school education, I'm also proudly supporting the bill that you discussed, because as a parent of you know, private school students, I want to make sure that my kids are getting the best education, and I'm going to do everything that I can. I look forward to the debate that you're going to bring to the conversation.
Well, I just want to make sure that a tax credit is a completely more generous provision than a tax deduction. And not only that, but the bill itself doesn't count. Over and above the $250 million, the bill does not count the uncounted expenses for the supplies.
These are really serious issues that could be a hearing in themselves. I have to ask, we really weren't going to take any questions. I know Phil asked, and I think we're ready to wrap up. We appreciate everyone's patience. Okay. That summarize our Senate colleagues?
Thank you.
I tried to call on you earlier.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, stenographer. You were excellent, and you...
And the clock, the people who handle the clock in Ways and Means, we thank
Everything was wonderful, and we'll see you here tomorrow at 10 a.m., I think.
Thank you. We thank the staff, and Senator, it's been a pleasure, and thank you, each and every person. Thank you.